taking cold. These hands are meant to hold.
Thank you.
We talk about mechanical ventilation, all the things that we've talked about, if you've already sat through the mechanical ventilation and airway management and acid-base lectures, you've already got a really good handle on mechanical ventilation. Well, all the things that we talked about in those previous lectures, all those rules, like oxygenation is all about mean airway pressure, or CO2 manipulation is all about minute volume, blah, 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 blah. Well, guess what? That stuff is all exactly the same in kids as it is in adults. There are some little differences in the way that we mechanically ventilate kids. One of the things that we do tend to do a lot more in children than adults is we tend to do a lot more pressure ventilation. And remember that when we do pressure ventilation, we don't typically use an IE ratio. Instead, what we use is something called an I time, which all we're doing is measuring how long is the inspiratory time. So you could calculate an IE ratio just from knowing what the inspiratory time is and what the breath rate is. So for example, if I'm giving a patient 60 breaths a minute, that means that each breath is taking 1 second. If their inspiratory time is 0.5, that means their inspiratory time is half a second. So what is their IE ratio? It's 1:1 because they're getting half a second of inspiration, half a second of expiration. Remember that pulse oximetry and ETCO2 are standards of care in pediatric transport, just like they are in adults. And the other thing is, remember that we want to be really good about correlating our blood gases with our SpO2 and our ETCO2 to make sure that our values are correct, just like we do in adults. Okay, when we talk about child ventilator settings, this is by no means a definitive discussion of child ventilation. This is just some very simple kind of basic places to start. When we talk about ventilating a child, we usually start off with an FiO2 of 100 or 100%. When we're talking about the IE ratio in kids, they tend to breathe more 1:1 instead of 1:2 or 1:3 like we do in adults. So we typically use an IE ratio somewhere around 1:1. When we talk about the PIP, because they've got a smaller ET tube, they're going to have a higher PIP. So a lot of times we'll use a PIP of less than 40 is acceptable. When we talk about rates, a good starting rate for an average-sized kid, say anywhere from 2 to 10, is somewhere around 16 to 20 breaths a minute. And then obviously we're going to follow that just like we would do in an adult. If the CO2 is not adequately being cleared, then we're going to go up on the rate of the tidal volume. If the CO2 is being cleared too well, then we're going to go down on our rate and our tidal volume. Now, when we talk about tidal volume, remember the tidal volume, it's just like adults. We typically use a tidal volume somewhere around 6 to 10 cc's per kilo. Some of the literature now saying even smaller, maybe 6 to 8 cc's per kilo. And when we talk about PEEP, we want to use PEEP at somewhere around 3 to 5 centimeters of water. Okay, when we talk about infant ventilator settings, usually when we talk about infant ventilator settings, we usually start again in an FiO2 somewhere around 100%. And usually in kids that are less than a year old, we tend to really favor pressure ventilation. I don't know that that's necessarily so much based on science, it's just based on tradition. There may be some science behind it, but for whatever reason, in most PICUs, a lot of times kids who are less than a 1 year old get pressure ventilated. When we talk about setting up their ventilator settings, again, we want to start with an inspiratory time instead of an IE ratio. And we want to make sure that the inspiratory time is at least half a second. Anywhere from half a second to 1 second is a good inspiratory time for an infant. When we talk about the peak inspiratory pressure, we'd like to keep it no greater. We'd like to start at somewhere around 15 to 20. And remember, because we're pressure ventilating little ones, we are going to use the peak inspiratory pressure instead of a tidal volume. So we're going to use a peak inspiratory pressure of around 15 to 20, and we're going to assess, do we have a good tidal volume with that PIP of 15 to 20? Do we have good chest rise? Are we getting good lung sounds? Are we seeing an adequate CO2 and an adequate O2? If not, then is it because the peak inspiratory pressure is too low? If the peak inspiratory pressure is too low, then obviously we're going to go up on it so that we go up on the tidal volume. In contrast, if we find we're overventilating with the peak inspiratory pressure of, say, 15 to 20, then we might go the other way, although it would be pretty rare that we would be overventilating with the peak inspiratory pressure of 15 to 20. When we talk about a good starting rate for an infant, somewhere around 20 to 30 is probably a good ballpark. And when we talk about PEEP, again, in infants, we tend to put all infants on some level of PEEP, and again, usually 3 to 5 is adequate to start with. Okay, when we talk about ET tube sizes, we've already talked repeatedly about how to calculate ET tube size for a child, but you also need to know how to calculate ET tube size for an infant. And if the infant is less than 1 kilo, we typically use a 2.5 ET tube. If they're 1 to 2 kilos, a lot of times we'll use somewhere around a 3. If they're 2 to 3 kilos, we'll use an ET tube that's somewhere around 3 to 3.5. And finally, if the infant is greater than 3 kilos, we'll usually use somewhere around a 4 ET tube. Okay, when we talk about neonatal transport, when we're specifically transporting neonates, some other things that you want to think about. Remember that overstimulation produces hypertension, and remember that that's a big deal in neonatal patients. The more premature your patient is, the more hypertension is a bad thing. Because remember, one of the last things to form in your last couple weeks that you're in utero is the completion of your blood-brain barrier. And when we have neonates become hypertensive because of overstimulation, it's not uncommon for that to create intracerebral bleeds. Now, when we talk about what we want to do for these patients, obviously we want to limit their stimulus, so we want to think about putting them someplace that's quiet and dark, like where they came from. Remember that we want to do things like using our isolate covers to prevent them from being exposed to excessive noise and light. The other things we want to think about is remember that when they're in the isolate, they're warm. Every time we open the isolate, we let cold air in. So we really want to do what we can to try and limit stimulation in order to decrease the chance of hypertension and also to decrease the chance of hypothermia in these really, really little ones. And again, the more premature they are, the more critical this becomes. Okay, when we talk about isolate use, you need to know who needs an isolate, and the standards are published by the American Academy of Pediatrics. And basically what they say is any child who is less than 5 kilos or any child who is less than 30 days corrected age probably should be transported in an isolate. Remember, the big reason why the isolate is so important is because it helps with thermoregulation, it helps to limit stimulus, and also it's got most of our isolates have all kinds of other equipment on them that we can use too that are specific to PEDS patients, like our specific ventilators and those types of things. Okay, when we talk about the isolate, remember the isolate is not an oven. You don't set it at what you want the patient to be. So for instance, if you want the kid to be 37 degrees Celsius, that doesn't mean you set the isolate at 37 degrees. It depends on how premature the child is as to how much we're going to set the temperature of the isolate. The other thing is it depends whether or not the child is clothed or covered. You've got some generalizations there. For a kid who weighs greater than 2,500 grams or 2.5 kilos, if they were clothed, we'd probably want to set the isolate somewhere around 28 degrees. If they were naked, we'd probably want it to be a little warmer, somewhere around 33 degrees. If they're between 1.5 kilos and 2.5 kilos, we usually use temperatures of 31 degrees and 35.5 degrees Celsius to keep them warm. Again, depending on whether they're clothed or they're naked. And finally, if they're less than 1.5 kilos or less than 1,500 grams, then usually if they're clothed, we usually set our isolate somewhere around 33 degrees. And if they're exposed, then we really need to put a lot of heat on those kids and we keep them somewhere around 36.5. But again, remember that these are just starting temperatures. These are just ballparks. Really, you should be watching with a skin probe and with a backup method transiently to make sure, with the skin probe continuously and with a backup method transiently to make sure you're keeping that kid warm enough. And if you're not, then go up on your isolate. If you're keeping them too warm, we don't want that either. That can be just as harmful, so we need to go down on the temperature on our isolate. Kim, when we talk about other things we can do to keep these little ones warm, remember that you want to pre-warm your isolate. It takes time for it to reach that temperature, so you want to do that ahead of time before you actually put the kid in it. Remember, you want to check the battery to make sure that you've got plenty of battery space to last you through your transport. You also want to keep the transport vehicle warm. That becomes more important the more interventions you need to do for this kid. If you've got to do lots and lots of things for them, in other words, if you're going to have the isolate open a lot of the time, then you really, really want to make sure that ambulance or that aircraft stays really, really warm. You want to keep their head dry and you want to keep their head covered. Remember, kids lose lots and lots of heat through their head. We can also do things like we can warm the gases. We can put commercial heat packs up against them as long as we make sure that those heat packs aren't going to cause any skin damage. Some of the things that are commonly done are wrapping them in foil or wrapping them in saran wrap. The other thing we can do if they've got any open defects is we can cover those defects with an occlusive dressing after they've been covered with a moist dressing that has been moistened with warm fluid. And finally, if we're giving the kid lots and lots of fluid, we would also like to warm those fluids.